Amen. Everybody say praise the Lord. How many's glad when they said unto you, let us go into the house of the Lord? Let's give them another hand clap today. Isn't God good to us? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. God bless you today. You can be seated. We're so excited to have everybody here for Sunday school today. This is our fifth Sunday. Every fifth Sunday, we have what we call a panel. And we get we pick out four people in this congregation, and usually it's teachers or somebody that would like to speak, and we try to put them on a panel. And this time, what we're going to do is, for the last 7 weeks, we've had Sunday school lessons out of our Sunday school book for the adult classes, and we took questions out of the back of every lesson, and one or two out of each lesson, and we're going to discuss the lessons that we've taught in the last 7 weeks. And we're going to get our panel, if they would, if you'll come this morning, and let's get started on our questioning that we have. But this is what we do every fifth Sunday, so I want you guys to remember that. We've done it all year last year, and we're going to do it this year. We have what we call a panel, and we have done some very good panels, and I think today we have some good questions as well. To go over, but I remember one we done one time was called Bridging the Gap, and between age groups, and there is a big age group that's in churches today, but you can't have the gap between the youth and the elder. We got to worship no matter our age, right? No matter if we're 18 or if we're 85, it doesn't matter. We still have to worship. So I think we have a worshiping church that agree, and I think we do that as well. So today, thank you for coming on our fifth Sunday, and also the last Sunday. Always remember, even if it's just the last Sunday, they're going to have a mega children's church, and all the Sunday school teachers get a break except for the adult classes. We have regular class for the adult classes, even in the New Life class and the 2020 class. You still have class on the last Sunday, but the children will be having mega children's church every last Sunday of the year. So keep that in mind, okay, so we know our direction and the way we're going. But how many is excited what God is doing? I'm so excited what God is doing. And everything you see when you drove up today, everything you walked into today, belongs to God. And we need to keep that in our mind. The car you drove today belongs to God. The house you got out of today, walked to come here, belongs to God. You know, God gives us all the stuff we have, if you want to call it stuff. God made us servants over it. And he wants to see how good we take care of it and how good we bless it. And, you know, if we take care of it, he keeps giving us more and more. So how many is thankful for what you have today? Would you just lift your hand and say, thank you, Lord, for everything you have let me be a servant over. Thank you, Lord, everything you have blessed my life with. We just graciously appreciate you today. But I'm going to get right into the questions today. I've asked the four adult teachers that are the ones majorly or the mainly used on every Sunday. From still standing is from your right to your left is Sister Joyce Turner, and then Brother Brad Blanton is in the colorful suit, and then Brother Zombic is in the gray suit, and Brother Patton is in the gray and black here. So these are great teachers. They study and they pray and they read the Word of God, and I'm excited to have all four of them on staff here at the church teaching and about God's Word. We're going to start right from week one from our Sunday school lesson. This comes straight out of our lesson. So if you got your pamphlet today, you still got that little lesson that we started with. This is where we're going to go with the question from that lesson. And I'm going to ask Brother Billy Patton, if he would, to start off the questions today. And the question is this: why is stability so important to Christian service?
In lesson one, if you would remember, we had Samuel. Samuel was the stabilizing force for new nation of Israel. He was, this new nation needed a king, and Samuel went and anointed Saul, and then later on he went and anointed David. But Samuel was the stabilizing force, and in that lesson we talked extensively about the part that Samuel played. But the question was, why is it so important for Christian service? In the lesson we taught that Christians grow in grace and mature spiritually in three different stages. The first stage is they come in, they repent, they come down to an altar, they ask the Lord to forgive them of their sins. Typically, sometimes they're baptized, other times they receive the Holy Ghost before they're baptized, but baptism is important. But the conversion process is that first stage. And so The second stage of Christian growth is the development. And the development stage is cultivating and learning. In Collierville First Pentecostal Church, we generally have a new life class, which is taught by Brother Max. And in that class, we talk about a healthy development of a new Christian, how that they need to establish a walk with God, a personal walk with God. And the development phase is the stabilizer of the Christian faith. It is the phase that a young convert can come to grips with the different doctrines that are taught, different holiness standards, and why we adhere to them, principles and guidelines. But the development phases is probably the stabilization phase before they get to the service stage. That's the third stage, is how can they give back? How can they serve? Everyone should have a place in the body. Everyone should have a ministry. There's nobody that's sitting here that, under the sound of my voice, that should not have a ministry. If someone comes up to you and say, what is your ministry? That you should be able to define that. If you have matured above the conversion process, the development stage of where you found out about the principles and you've conformed to some of the different guidelines that are taught in the Bible, then that everyone here should have a service, a ministry, if you would. Here we have ladies ministry. We have the pastor's prayer force. We have the outreach. Everyone can be a part of the outreach team. There's always something. There's a benevolence. You could be part of benevolence. People pass away, you know, getting together meals to take out. There's a place in the body for every person. But stabilizing roots are essential in order to grow into the next stage of maturity or achievement of Christian. So becoming actively involved is stabilizing. If you are actively involved, you'll find out that you're needed. Your service is wanted. It is desired. And so each person, you don't look at your toe and say, you know, I don't need you anymore. I promise you, when you trip across your bed in the middle of the night, you find out that toe is needed. And so such it is with every member of the body. But the conversion process, the development process, and finding a place in the body is all critical to the stability of a new convert and a Christian in Christian service.
Let's give Brother Patton a hand for that. A good answer. Anyone like to make a comment on that? Anybody about being stability in the church? I think we have to be stable, because if you don't get stable, you'll fall for any little thing that comes across your way. But if you stay stable, you can deal with the toe ache or the finger ache or whatever it is. You deal with it and move on when you're stable. So it's good to have. And I did today forget something. Ushers, if you'd come, forgot our Sunday school offering. We had to take up Sunday school offering and give you a chance to give in that. I don't guess it's a certain time you got to take it up, so it works all right. And give you a chance to give in Sunday school offering. This is if you would give in whatever class you go to, just put it in this offering today. Lord, we love you. Thank you for this opportunity to give in this offering. We pray that you use it, bless it, Lord, for by these literature for Sunday school classes and by the things we need, and ask you to bless those that give in this Sunday school offering today. In Jesus' name we praise you. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for giving. And while they're doing that, we're going to go right into the second question so we can kind of cover these today. But Brother Zombic, we've asked him to do the second question. And we'd like Brother Zombic to discuss why David seemed always to respond positively to correction. Brother Zombic.
Thank you, Brother Hunt. David, if there was ever a character in the Bible that was exposed from top to bottom, it was David. And we can understand and know David through what is written by others, what was said by God, and what he expressed in the 73 Psalms. Psalms, of course, are poetry, words, and music, and song to the Lord. And 73 of the Psalms are written by David. I'm going to just point out 10 things of character about David that you'll find in the Psalms that will show you and I what kind of man he was. Now, the scripture does say that all have come short of the glory of God, right? All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But even though David wasn't perfect, and though surely we are not perfect, that God sees the man's heart, and he testifies about individuals in the scripture. Well, let's start with the scripture in Acts chapter 13:22. It says, God made a testimony and said that I have found David, son of Jesse, a man after my own heart. He will do everything I want him to do. And here we have God's testimony about the man, saying that I can trust him. Whatever I say, David does. Now, that wasn't testified about Saul, the first king. Saul was concerned about the people and the will of the people, where David was concerned about the will of God. And so in Psalm 62:9, it talks about David and that he was humble. And you can, that, I mean, right there, that's why he responded the way he did to God when he fell short. So he was humble in Psalm 62:9. He was reverent. He respected God and authority. And that you'll find in Psalms 18:13. So when I went through the scripture here, I'm giving you the reason why David responded correctly because of these characteristics about him. He was respectful. Psalm 31:9. He was trusting. Psalm 27:1. He was loving. Psalm 18:1. He was devoted. And that was Psalm 4:7. He was a worshiper. Anybody deny that? You'll see that through all the Psalms, but I just put Psalm 9:1. He was faithful. That's Psalm 23:6. He was obedient. Psalm 119:34. And he was repentant. Psalm 25:11. And so these characteristics, there's 10 of them, real quick. We don't have, you know, a whole lot of time to deal with it, but these 10 things define David in a very positive way. And God testified about it. I'd like to go and just go into Psalm 51. And I'm going to read that psalm. There's some very potent things in that psalm. And it says this in the Psalm of David. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according unto the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgression. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against thee and thee only have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, and thou mightest be justified when thou speakest, and be clear when thou judgest. Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me. Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts. There you go, inward parts. And in the hidden parts thou shalt make me to know wisdom. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me to hear joy and gladness, that the bones which thou hast broken may rejoice. Hide thy face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create, and this is the verse that highlights it, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me in with thy free spirit. Then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners shall be converted unto thee. And so David just was an open book to God. Yes, he was not perfect, but he had a heart that sought God, that pursued God, and that would not let up. And God saw it. And God did great things through David. And I think that's why David responded always correct before the Lord. Not all kings, when they were put on the spot by the prophets, responded like David responded. Some of them killed the prophets. David did not. He repented. And so I think looking at the character of David and understanding that even God's testimony says, I found David. He's a man after my own heart. He'll do everything that I'll want him to do. And so the will of God is important, and David carried it out.
Amen. Let's give him a hand for that one. That's good. Good answers. The question would be, who here would not want to be a man or a woman after God's own heart? We all would love that, to have that response about us. And, you know, when they bury all of us, we would love to, them to tell us, man, he loved God. He was a man after God's own heart. I think one of the biggest things that would help us is to learn how to take correction in our lives. Listen to correction, and not only listen, but respond to it. And he didn't just listen, but he responded. Like the prophet said, you're the man at one time. David turned around and responded, says, oh God, oh Lord. And you heard the Psalms 51 there, how he repented. Create in me, oh God. So I want to respond to correction in the right way. Amen. So help me, Lord, to do that, because the flesh don't want to do that. We all can say amen to that. The flesh does not like correction. But when we respond the right way, God bless us. Anybody want to make a comment on that today? Before we go to question number three, Sister Zombie.
David was always quick to repent. But one thing I really admire about him that we can connect to in our life is this. David allowed God to sweep through his whole heart. He didn't keep chambers of secrets and chambers of sin and chambers of pride all hidden away. Sometimes we today allow God to deal with 95% of our heart, but that's not going to cut it. We have to allow the Spirit of God to deal, as David did, with 100% of our being and our heart. And I've often wondered, hey, David, you killed people. You committed worse sexual sins. What's with it? You're God's own heart person. But you know what? It's because that heart was open, every bit of it, every drop of it, every being in his bones. He opened up to God and allowed God to deal with it.
Praise the Lord. That's good. Can we all just say this? Help me, Lord. Help me to have that heart, the right heart. Help me in Jesus' name. Let's go right on to number three, Brother Brad Blanton. We're going to discuss the long-term consequences of sin, even though it is forgiven. Brother Brad, could you address that?
Well, praise the Lord, everyone. I'm already feeling the Holy Ghost up here. You know, I jotted down some notes yesterday, and they are these. Even though God forgives us and he remembers our transgressions no more, as far as the east is from the west, he has removed our transgressions from us. He cast our sins behind his back. And the scripture says when he forgives us, he puts them in a sea of forgetfulness. Somebody one time said and posted a no fishing sign. So I thank God that he does forgive and he cleanses us from our sins and remembers them no more. But there are consequences to our sins and to our actions. He was quoting from Psalm 51 when David had repented when he committed adultery with Bathsheba and had her husband Uriah the Hittite killed with the sword of the enemy. There are consequences to our actions. For an example, you may come to God. By his mercy, he forgives you, cleanses you, remembers your sin no more. But if you were a criminal, you had committed a crime, you still have to go to jail or to prison. If you've abused your body through the years, when you become saved, you still may reap what you have done. If you've abused your body with alcohol or tobacco or drugs, there's still consequences to our actions. And I realize that our God not only forgives, He's able to heal us. We understand that. But in many cases, again, what we have sown, well, Paul said, be not deceived, whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. For an example, David committed adultery and did what he did. I just quoted, he had a lot of problem in his family. If a person, say, commits adultery, God will forgive him, but he may go through a divorce. So there are consequences to our actions, whether it's spiritual loss, physical loss, materialism. People go to casinos and they gamble, and I've heard some walk down Highway 61 going home because they've lost their automobile and their house and their business. So there are consequences. The scripture again says, be not deceived. God is not mocked. And so these are a few things, but ultimately the thing that we have a long-term consequence of, if it's not forgiven, is eternal damnation and separation from God. We usually say, I don't know about you, but I do know about you and myself. We don't want to go to a place the Bible calls hell. So we repent of our sins, ask God to forgive us. He forgives us, and I believe He will at times heal those that are bringing scars and wounds from their sinful life into the church with them, so to speak. That's the kind of God we serve. And I'll stop after saying this. The Bible says, for the wages of sin is death. Sin has a paycheck. When you work, you want to get paid. And when sin's through, it says, here's your paycheck, death. Physical death, spiritual death, and again, eternal separation and damnation. But Brother Hunt, I'm thankful there's a gift, not a wage, but God freely gives a gift of eternal life to those who will believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, repent of their sins, and obey the gospel. So there are consequences. God said, Adam, what have you done? Adam tried to blame Eve. He asked Eve. Eve blamed it on the serpent. And I guess if the serpent would have spoke, he would have said, the devil made me do it. But everyone's accountable for your own actions. But thank God we serve a merciful God. And if we sin, thank God we have an advocate with the Father. Praise. Confess those sins. That blood will cleanse us, and He'll make us whiter than snow.
Amen. God, how many is thankful for forgiveness?
Feel the Holy Ghost this morning.
Amen. Woo! Thankful for forgiveness. Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
I remember one time I went to hospital and visited a gentleman that attended church here, and he was in his last days, and he looked at me, and he had the Holy Ghost. He was faithful to church, and he looked at me. He says, Brother Hunt, he says, I'm paying for my BC life before Christ. He still had to pay the consequences from the sin that he let go into his body. And unless God heals you, we're going to have to pay for that price. But you know what? I can go to heaven with that sickness or whatever I have messed up in my body. But I can't go to heaven without the Holy Ghost. Amen. And I'm glad I got the Holy Ghost today. God's forgive me for my past. And I'm thankful for forgiveness. And guess what? If you got a situation in your life, God wants to forgive you today too. All you got to do is say, He says, you have not because you ask not. And if we ask, He'll give it to us. And I want you to know God is still in the forgiving business. Amen. Go right into week number two, and a question from that lesson. Sister Turner, in light of the prophet's role, discuss how we hear the voice of the Lord today as Christians.
Romans 10, verse 13. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. How then shall they call upon him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? In the Old Testament, the prophet was the voice of God. They did not have access to God the way that we do today. But to me, the Word of God teaches that the way that the voice of God today, the foremost voice of God today, is through the preacher. It is through the Word of God being preached. It's through the Word of God being taught. We can also hear the voice of God through prayer as a Christian. The Spirit of God can talk to us. Also, we can hear the voice of God this Word of God is God in written form. And so we hear from God, the voice of God, through the Word. The Bible says we are washed by the water of the Word. We hear through the Word of God by reading, by studying. Also in Corinthians, it tells us that there is the gift of prophecy. We hear the Word through prophecy. And also that through the gift of tongues and interpretation, you also hear the Word of God through that. And we do know, and we all know, that as far as prophecy, as far as tongues and interpretation, or the Spirit of God speaking to us in prayer, it always lines up with God's Word. But the foremost way that we are going to hear is just like the sinner that comes in and hears the Word of God preached. As Christians, our foremost way of hearing the voice of God is through the man of God when he brings the Word of God.
Praise the Lord. Good answer. Well, I believe it is. The Bible does say, know them that labor among you. We need to know who is preaching to us, know who is teaching to us. But it is good to hear the Word of God and know that it is from God. If it don't match the Bible, you might ought to stay away from it. It's same with tongue interpretation. We need more of it in our churches. But if it don't line up with the Word of God, you need to stay away from it. Amen. It's going to line up with what the Word says. So, and I believe that as well. Good. Anybody want to make a comment on that one? Anybody on the board or the panel want to make a comment? Anybody? You're welcome to. All right.
Brother,
let's go.
Hunt, I would like to add to that. The Bible says, study to show thyself approved unto God. When we come to God, we need to get into the Word of God for ourselves. That doesn't mean we become over the minister. That doesn't mean that we have understanding that the minister doesn't have. But that also means that if you will get in the Word of God for yourself, when it comes across the pulpit or however it comes to you through someone witnessing to you or whatever, if you know the Word of God, you'll know the difference between truth and error.
Amen. That's good. That is good. Anybody else want to make a comment on the voice of God? Brother Aaron? That's good. That's good. Amen. How many is excited for the voice of God? I love it. Praise the Lord. And always remember this. Sometimes you ever have that little voice come in your head, and if we're not careful, we'll blame every voice in our head. God told me. God showed me. God told me. We've got to be careful, because sometimes it's your emotions getting overexcited, and you got that emotion going about you, because if it's anything against this right here, God didn't tell you. Okay, remember, if it's anything against that, God didn't tell you to go and steal. He didn't tell you to go. And I had a man one time that stood up in church and testified. He says, I just thank God. He says, I needed new tires on my truck. He said, I looked over by the tire store. They was leaning up against the building. God said, those are for you. No, you went and stole four tires that was leaning against the tire store. You can't say stuff like this from God. You got to be careful in the voice of God. It's going to match with the Word of God. All right, let's go right into the next question so we can try to get some answer today. We're going to go back to Brother Blanton on this one. When I picked these questions out, I begin to look at them. I said, well, I think Brother Blant can do this one, Brother Zama can do this one, so that's why I mixed the names up here. But number five is in week number three lesson. How do you think, Brother Blanton, that Elijah would have reacted if he had been Elisha's servant instead of his master?
That's a good question. Some of it may be speculation. What I taught the other day, it's a powerful lesson. Elijah, my God is Jah, Jehovah. Elisha, my God is salvation. You know, when I looked at this and I considered it last night, I look at Elijah. Both were great men of God. There's no question. And Elijah and Elisha both mightily used of God and miraculous. Elisha probably twice as many miracles. When I look at Elisha, he was called the prophet of fire by many. He was very fierce, as some would say. But God has different positions and different people in those positions. In other words, let me word it this way. I see Elijah as a man, as James said, subject to like passions as we. It seemed like he's unstable. You talked about being stable on the first question. We've got to be stable in our walk with God. We've got to get a hold of our emotions. And I look at Elijah, he's calling fire down upon the altar, the sacrifice. You know the story. The fire of God fell, consumed it all. Later he calls fire down upon a captain and his 50 twice. But yet I see him another time running from a woman named Jezebel for his life. And he's hiding out in a cave, so to speak, with his head between his legs. And he's saying, Lord, take away my life. Now, if he wanted to die, Jezebel would have took care of that for him. But he's saying, Lord, I'm the only one left. They've digged down your altars, Father, Lord God of Israel. They've killed your prophets. I'm the only one left. Well, there were 7,000 men that God had that had not bowed to the image of Baal. And so he wasn't the only one left, and he really didn't want to die, but he's fleeing. Paul said he made intercession against Israel. He didn't pray for Israel, he prayed against them. And so it seems he's up and he's down. Well, he's still walking with God, but he's up and he's down at times. But when I look at Elisha, my God is salvation, he seemed to be stable, as you talked about, Brother Patton. I don't see that he was up and down, so not in and out of church, so to speak, but I believe if Elijah was under Elisha's ministry, reversed the role, I've got to believe Elijah could have learned something, though both of them were mighty men of God. I believe perhaps he could have looked at the life of Elisha and saw his stability. He has control of his emotions. Again, not up and down, in and out, so to speak. And I think that's one of the characteristics that you and I as apostolic people need, and I'm talking to you and to myself. We need to be stable. Our God never changes. He's always the same yesterday, today, and forever, and we need to be stable. And so that's what I say, Pastor. I believe that if he would have been under Elijah or under Elisha, perhaps Elijah could have seen how stable and consistent and in control this man was with his feelings and his emotions. That's my answer.
That's a good answer. That's good. Let's give him a hand clap for that answer. I believe if the Bible would give us more history on Elijah, we'd probably find out Elijah was a stable person before he became the prophet even. He probably was faithful to whoever his leader was. And a lot of times you get a man of God that is a good speaker or a good preacher or a good pastor or whatever he does, it's probably because he was a good a follower before he became a leader. And I think it's very important if you ever think God's going to use you in pastoring or being a leader in the future of whatever in life, you need to become the best servant first. The best person you can be, the best teacher, the best outreacher, whatever you can be. You don't wait until your row is called, then that's the only time you participate. But while you're waiting till that row time's called, just become the most faithful, the hardest working person in the church. Hey, then God's going to pull you into a row like he was Elijah. So I like that. That's a good answer. Anybody want to make a comment on that before we go any further? All right, we got about 10, 15 minutes. We're going to try to get some more answered here. Let's go right into Brother Zombic, back to him on week number three, where's the lesson taught. And talked about Elisha again, but what did Elisha ask, or why do you think Elisha asked for a double portion of Elijah's spirit? And what was his motivation? Can you discuss on that for a minute, Brother Zomp?
Well, that's a tough one. How do you know the motivation and the heart? And you really don't. Only God knows the heart. And, you know, even the prophet didn't pick David. When all through his brothers, oh, this has got to be him. Samuel, oh, this is, you know. And no, it's David. And so, to judge a man's motivation, all you have to do is look at his life. And I think stability, which is mentioned, and how it panned out, then you say, okay, the motivation was right. But at the very beginning, you don't know the motivation. You know, there's a lot of men that say things, and you take them at their word, but you don't know the motive of the heart. And you see that all the time with politicians. They will say anything you want to hear to get elected, but once they're elected, they will either not do what they promised or do the very opposite. And you see that in the spy net. When the spies go into different nations, you have sometimes spies that have the right motivation. You got other spies that are double agents. They don't have anything that, you know, is money talks, and I'll just be a traitor to anybody, just come up with the money. But when I look at Elisha, mentioned before, God is my salvation. And he was picked by Elijah. He was just out there in the farmland with 12 oxen yoked up, doing his job, not, you know, just focused. I'm going to do what my parents said to do. I'm going to farm the land. Here comes the prophet and picks him out. Now, he had a choice right then and there what to do. He could have just said, no, I can't do it. Like Jesus said when he said about the wedding, picked out different people, and they all had excuses. Well, Elisha didn't have any excuse. He just went back to his parents and asked the prophet to do it. The prophet came by. He asked me to follow him, and I'm going to do it. And so that tells me it wasn't self-centered, that he was denying self to leave his parents, leave his family and land, and just go off with the prophet, just like Jesus picking out the disciples. And the disciples left all that they had and just followed Christ. They didn't know what to expect. So the motive had to be right. And it played out that Elisha, the motive was right. Everything he did. And what really is a highlight of this is that I kind of compare him with Joshua. There was a lot of leaders in Israel, but Joshua stood by Moses' side to assist him no matter what. And he was the one that God picked. And so it was with Elijah. He stood right by Elijah. Even though Elijah said, stay here. I'm going to Bethel. I'm going to these other places. Stay here. And he said, no, I'm not staying here. I'm going with you. But the rest of the sons of the prophets stood afar off. And so that tells you a lot about Elisha. And I think being a servant and being of service no matter what the cost, that's a good motivation of heart.
That's good. Amen. Motivated for the right reason, right? Good. Thank you. Now, some of you guys that are Bible scholars may have to correct me a little bit, but I didn't read this before today, but I have read it. Did when he called for Elisha, come, you know, throw his mantle on Elisha, did he not sacrifice the oxen that was pulling the right then? And I thought, was thinking there that his motivation was, I ain't coming back. I'm going with a prophet, and I ain't coming back. In other words, I'm going to get rid of what I could go back to. And we get the right motivation. If God delivers you from something, you're going to get rid of it because I'm not going back. And that's where Elisha was. I ain't going back to that. And so his motivation, well, I'm going toward to what this man of God has got going on. And if you'll read, you'll find out Elisha done double the miracles that Elijah done. Because he says, you know what? God done great things through Elijah, but I believe that God can even do more than that. So that is great motivation. And he did. He saw twice the miracles that Elijah saw. Anybody want to make a comment on that today before we go further? Brother Mike? Wow, yeah. He had to have the double anointing, so that's good. And the thing is you think about it, he didn't just go with Elijah through the pretty things, but he went through with Elijah through the ugly things. And he said, wherever you go, I'm going. And think about it, if he had not went through that sea that he went through when he divided, and they went over and Elijah was called away in a chariot, and if he had not been there, the mantle would have failed and he wouldn't have grabbed it. But he was said, I'm going with you. So I encourage you today, stay close to the house of God. Stay close to the Spirit of God, because you never know where God's going to put you in and what level of life he's going to use you in. So stay close to that, okay? Anybody else want to make a comment, Sister Turner?
That mantle was the anointing.
Yes.
And there's something about the anointing that once you experience it, it's almost like, this is a horrible word, I guess, but you can't get enough of it. There's nothing like the anointing of God, because that is the very presence of God that comes up on you and upon what you are doing. And I think once that Elisha experienced that anointing, it's like, I've got to have more. I want more. I want what Elijah's got, but I want more than what he had. I want to see the manifestation of God done even more than what Elijah had.
Amen to that. Praise the Lord. We're going to have to skip a couple questions, guys. So I'm going to go right down to number 9 for Brother Child back there. Number 9 is from week 5, and I've asked Brother Billy Patton to help us discuss on this. But the question was, and these come straight out of the book, so discuss ways we can reach out to backsliders and let them know God wants to forgive them and raise them up again. Discuss that with us a minute, Brother Patton.
Well, I believe that, first of all, they got to know you care. Nobody wants to hear nothing that you have to say if you don't care about it. So I would say the first thing that I've tried to implement in my life is start with just three or four that you know personally, three or four that may have attended church with you in the past, and pick them out, pray about it, pray about taking them on as a burden. You have a burden for somebody, then you'll be passionate about keeping up with them. Don't be annoying, but let them know that you care and that you're not going to give up on them regardless of what they say or what they think. I'm not going to give up on you. And tell them straight up, I'm not giving up. I know that you've gone through, and they'll have different reasons. They'll say, you know, well, this one, he sat in my place at church, or that one, you know, he said something to me, or this one, he was mean to me, or, you know, the church is full of hypocrites. Just look at him straight in the eye and say, you know, regardless, I'm not going to give up on you. When their birthday comes around, call them, tell them happy birthday, send them a birthday card. Anniversaries, remember that. Show them that you're not going away. You're there for them regardless. We became bonded when you were part of the body of Christ, and just because you've abandoned your family, I'm not going to give up on you. You know, if your son don't want to hear from you and he leaves your home, you don't abandon him. What do? You reach out to him. You say, hey, look, son, you always got a place here. You can come visit anytime you want to. You know, all of that's going to be forgiven. Invite them out. invite them out once a month, just one time a month. Invite them to lunch, invite them to fellowship, maybe your home fellowship group, but keep inviting. At some point, consistency is the key here. At some point, you are going to hit the part that they're going through a weak time. They're going to be saying, you know, Lord, I don't know how I'm going to make it this week. And at some point, you're going to hit them at a weak point. And because you are consistent in showing them you care, showing them that they do matter, I think you'll reap big benefits out of it. I have three or four. I went to lunch with one of them this week. He told me he's not going to come here, but he is going to go to another Pentecostal church where his kids attend. And as he left, he got tears in his eyes and he said, you know, Billy, thanks for not giving up on me. You're the only one out of a church of 600 that has consistently tried to call me and talk to me about the Lord and that I needed to get back to church, and I know where I need to be. So don't give up on them. Backsliders, they can upslide just as good as they backslide. So just keep that in mind. They are a child of God. Treat them like you would if it was your kid that was not responding to your Thanksgiving Day dinners. Yeah, you know, you just keep inviting them. They're your baby, right? They're your brother. So I'd say start with two or three. Just find two or three that used to go to church with you, used to attend church with you, and put a passion in your heart. There's one that used to preach sermons here. Keep fishing. Let's go fishing. He's on my heart. And I guarantee if you sit in your car and you just think about it on your way home, you know two or three yourself. Reach out to them. Tell them that they matter. Tell them that they care.
Amen. Very good. Very good. Let's give him a hand on that one for backsliders. How many here knows a backslider? Raise your hand. If you know somebody used to go to church, don't go to church no more, raise your hand high. Raise it high. I want to see it. You know what? Let's go get them. How about it? Let's go get them. Let's go invite them back to the house of God. Let's tell them God loves them. Come on, God didn't give up on them. Ain't you glad God didn't give up on you? God didn't stop on you. Praise the Lord. He did not stop on you. Just real quick, can we go one more question? We got extra 5 minutes today. This is going to be the last one on the list, and I give all of you guys just opportunity to speak on it. I thought it was very good. And like I said, these come out of week 7, which we just got through teaching last week. What is the message of hope for the church today? And Sister Turner, if you'll just take a minute and go right down the line.
Can I just take a minute or five?
1 minute. You get a minute because it's got to be five between all of y'all. So, but just take, what is the message of hope for the church today?
The message of hope for today that I see for the church is that God says, I change not. God's the same God he's always been. Jesus Christ says he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Anything that God has ever done in the church before, he will continue to do. The same love that he had for the apostolic church in the book of Acts, it's still real today. He is the same. And anything that the future of the church or the hope of the church today is the same thing that it has always been. And that is that we serve a risen Savior. We serve a Savior that loves his desire, his reason for Calvary, his reason for crucifixion, his reason for shedding his blood was for the salvation of souls. And it still stands today. The Bible says, whosoever will, let him come. Let him call upon the name of the Lord. And that is the hope of the church today. And it even goes beyond that hope. It goes on to the hope that if we endure until the end, we'll look upon his face.
Amen. That's good. Praise the Lord. Brother Brad Blanton, comment on that.
She said pretty much what I had written down. The gospel never changes. The church never changes. The hope they had in Acts chapter 2, Pastor Hunt's the same hope we have today. Thank God there's only one hope. The Bible says one body, one spirit, one hope. Aren't you thankful? One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father, who's above all, through all, and in you all. There's still only one name for salvation, only one God. So this is the hope. And the Bible says, hope thou in God.
Amen.
Because hope, Paul said in Romans 5, maketh not ashamed. So no matter what you and I go through, in this generation or in the future or those back in the past, as Sister Turner said, nothing changes. I say get in church and stay in church, and God will never let
Amen.
You down.
Praise
and
the Lord.
I feel
Lord.
The Holy
good.
Ghost
Hallelujah.
This morning. He is our hope.
Praise God.
Praise the name of the Lord.
Brother Zombic, what do you see today in hope in the church?
Anything to add to that? Yes. Gospel. That's the hope of this world. Good news.
Yes.
Glad tidings. Amen. That's what it is. And that's to all people, all tribes, every tongue.
Yes.
And I don't care where you are, what color you are, or whatever your background is. When I look and see what, you know, David's mighty army was chosen by just has-beens, forget-me-nots, and God made them a mighty force. And I look at the chosen ones that Jesus picked out. He didn't go to the all these universities and stuff to pick out his team. He went to the fishermen,
yeah,
the taxpayer, just everyday people. And I think that brings great hope, knowing that God will do beyond what you can even ask or think.
That's right.
And I think that's a great hope.
Praise God.
He's still on the throne. That's a hope. And nothing's going to change. And so when we think about all what we're faced in this world, the violence, the evil, and all these things that are going on, we have a hope. And the hope is in the church. And Jesus Christ
Amen.
Is that hope.
Amen. God bless you. That's good. Brother Patton, finish us up there. What do you say the
what
message
is,
of hope
what
is?
What is the message of hope? Ditto. What these guys say.
Yeah.
What is the message of hope for the church today? It said that he was slain from the foundation of the world, meaning that God put the restoration process in place before the foundation of the world. So because he put the restoration process in place, every single person that would come to God would be restored. No one has gone too far that they can't be restored.
Praise God.
So the message
Amen.
Is restoration in
Yes.
to the body of Christ. No matter how far you've gone, you can be restored.
Praise the Lord. Let's give our panel a hand today. Thank you, guys. How many is ready to have church today? Let's let God flow in this place. Let anointing of God touch lives. We're going to take about 5 minutes, set the stage back up, but we're going to go right into our worship service. Thank you for coming to Sunday school today. God bless you. If I can get a couple strong men to help me set this stage back up, please. Thank you.